Greetings from Singapore. But first, before we start, I'd like to say hello to my friends in Siberia at the Academy of Public Administration, Marina, Professor Elder Safti, Alina, Vita, Olga, and everybody else. I'd like to thank my friends here, Andrew, and for helping to make this recording.
Singapore is well known all over the world for, you know, corruption-free status. What do you think are the, how does the government deal or prevent corruption in Singapore? And what measures specifically of fighting corruption does the government use?
Of course, some people have said that Singapore is the least corrupt country in Asia, because it has the highest paid government in the world. Our president and prime minister is paid more than $2 million a year, and our ministers are paid more than $1 million a year. But having said that, I think the main reasons why Singapore has been successful has been our very, pragmatic approach to tackling corruption. You see, there are two factors that contribute to combating corruption, and they are how easy it is to be caught and how severe is the penalty. First, let me talk a bit about how easy to be caught. When I was a young boy, corruption was quite rampant. I mean, you know, you had to pay money anywhere, everywhere to get things done. We set up a corrupt practices investigation bureau and a hotline. Anyone could call the hotline and accuse someone else of corruption, and there will be an investigation. Now, of course, if the person who makes the call makes a false accusation, he or she will get into serious trouble as well. So it became very easy, at least for people who are corrupt, to think that it's very easy to be caught because someone could just make a call to the hotline. Next, let me talk a bit about the severity of the penalty, because if the penalty is not severe enough, then corruption will continue. It requires the top leadership of the country to be serious about corruption. So the first thing we did was, I remember, that one of our cabinet ministers, in fact our national development minister, was one of the first to be caught for corruption. And he actually hanged himself, he killed himself, committed suicide. Now, of course, that is the most severe of all penalties.
Next question. Do you believe the level of corruption to be higher in either an open or closed economy? Or how does the openness of a country's economy influence the level of corruption?
Of course, Singapore is one of the most open economies in the world. I think that has contributed to the fact that, you know, according to PRC, the Political, Economic and Risk Consultancy, that Singapore is the least corrupt country in Asia.
Do you believe corruption can have any positive consequences?
Well, I think corruption has to be tackled in stages. You can't move from corruption to zero corruption within a day or weeks. And I think in a sense, in the context of Singapore, corruption has in a way been quite useful. Let me explain what I'm trying to say. You see, for countries in the developed world, they have very strict corruption legislation and laws, and therefore it's very difficult for them to do business in countries that are notably very corrupt. And so they come through Singapore as a middleman. So Singapore in a sense acts as a middleman between very corrupt countries and countries that have very strict laws against corruption. And that has made Singapore one of the most successful trading nations in the world. Let's say a company in a developed world that has very strict laws wants to do business with another business in a country that's very corrupt. Of course, the easiest way is to go through a middleman such as Singapore. Now, Singapore goes to this corrupt country and deals with these corrupt people and perhaps pay them a consultant's fee or something, right? And insofar as the developed countries' company is concerned, they have not broken any laws because they have used a middleman. And Singapore has also not broken any laws because they have paid a consultant's fee which is transparent. We know the amount, we know why it's paid and to whom it has been paid.
If you were to name three examples, the three most important criteria as part of an anti-corruption strategy, what would they be?
Let me cite an example for you. When an African country's dictator was overthrown, they found US $100 million cash in his basement. So actually one important aspect of detecting corruption is to help people to understand how much money is enough. I mean, everybody wants money, but how much really is enough? So in the case of Singapore, we encourage civil servants from the top to the bottom, and of course from the bottom upwards, to do financial planning, which is we try to get them to think about their financial goals and concerns and see if, based on their current income and expenses, based on the estimated rise in their salary, say 5% a year, and if they feel that if they follow what they do now, they can buy a house, send the children for university education and retire, then there's really no need to be corrupt, because if you can earn enough and plan for your future, why do you need to be corrupt? I mean, corruption is a matter of degree. So if a person has enough to meet his financial goals and concerns, there's less likelihood that people will become corrupt.
It's almost impossible to eradicate corruption completely. What do you understand by the optimal level of corruption in a given country that may be acceptable?
I've seen countries that have had tremendous difficulty when they move from a very corrupt state and try to be corruption free, because you can end up with a situation where hardly anything works in a country anymore. So it has to be done in stages.
Final question. Is corruption found in the everyday life of Singapore's citizens?
Well, today, of course, we are one of the least corrupt countries in the world. But like I said earlier, when I was a young man, of course, corruption was everywhere. But I think that does not mean that, when Singaporeans go out of Singapore and do business, they are not totally incorruptible. And I'm not saying that they are corrupt. What I'm saying is this. If you do business in several countries which are notably very corrupt countries, you have to pay money to various people to get things done. So the key here is the form and the transparency of the payment. If you pay money to a certain person, as long as it's publicly disclosed, you know why the reason why the person was paid, what work did he do, what was the amount he was paid, then that's not corruption.